Hello YouTubers, and welcome to this next in the series on the Power Supply Project. And if you remember from the last video in the Power Supply Project, the key problem I said I'd address now was looking at feedback loop stability. And as noted, it's a very interesting topic. This topic, although we're going to be talking about this around op amps, it also relates to a multitude of control systems, whether they're in industry, whether they involve electronics, water, air pressure, anything which has got a feedback loop in a control system can potentially suffer from the same issues that we're going to look at in terms of, let's say, instability and oscillations happening at the output. There is a lot revolving around this topic that can cause a lot of confusion, because to properly understand the stability of, let's say, an op amp circuit, there are mathematical models which will describe how it is going to potentially behave. And those mathematical problems and equations relate to complex mass or complex numbers. So something which has got a real and an imaginary component. And we're talking about a polar axis. And you'll hear terms, if you go and look at videos, you might hear terms like zeros and nodes. And those all relate to, let's say, resolving the roots of a complex equation. The last time I dealt with complex mass was, let's say, when I did an exam for my ham radio. But if you're not using it, and people are using a terminology and then not relating it to perhaps a practical example and some analogies, you can become lost and detached very soon. So that's what I'm going to try and bring together, and hopefully at the end of this you'll walk out with a reasonably good understanding of the potential challenges of trying to keep a control system like an op amp that we've got in the power supply, trying to keep it stable. Now, when I go through this explanation, you're going to hear terms like, for instance, loop feedback, gain margin, phase margin, and all that kind of thing. And I will go into through the process of explaining those so that you gain an understanding of what they're about. Because I feel that's where often I was getting lost. People were using these terms, but yet not having an assumption that you know what those terms mean. So I'm going to go into this with trying to assume that you have very little knowledge and trying to explain that terminology. But before we do that, I'm going to take you back and have a look at the function that that op amp is performing so that I can explain the workings and how things go awry. So in the power supply, we've got an op amp which is there to basically receive feedback from the output and regulate it to keep it at a certain level. So it is receiving feedback to control what's happening at the output to, let's say, control, regulate, whether it's the voltage level or the current level, is trying to regulate or control that and keep it at a stable level. Now, in this top diagram over here, where I've got this triangle representing our op amp, we've got an output from that, which I've got in red, and then we've got the feedback, which comes back. This B or beta is the gain. And then that is fed back to an input for the op amp to make a decision whether it needs to pull the output up or down. And that ultimately is to control and regulate our output. And here the output level that we're trying to regulate, I've got in blue. We want to keep that stable or straight. But what can happen in a system like this is that we're not getting nice, clean, necessarily clean signals, DC signals, stable signals going back. We'll have signals which are changing over time. And this can be because we've got, let's say, an influence on the load. Something's happening on the load which is changing, and that change is being brought back in the form of kind of an AC signal. And of course, an AC signal going in is potentially going to have an AC signal coming out. Now, this valve over here is our control system, and in the power supply, our control system is a power transistor. This could be seen as a valve, like you're turning water on and off. As I said, these control systems and control loops, feedback loops, can relate to many systems. But in our case, that's a power transistor. And that is being controlled by the output of the op amp to ultimately control the output of your load. In our case, the power supply. Now, before we go off to the analogy, I'll just explain that the two key problems that can cause a system to become unstable or start oscillating is, for one, the gain, or the what's happening on the output over here in terms of the gain. So the gain, as you'll know, because it's called an op amp, we are putting, let's say, potentially a smaller signal in here. We have our rail-to-rail voltage, which is what this output is going to move to. So that's an amplified signal on the output, so that there's a gain. Now, it's not necessarily always an amplified signal. You could have a smaller signal, but that gain is a measure of how big or how small this signal relative to the input signal is. So any issues you have with that gain or the delay. So if we have our signal coming in here, which is saying, right, we need to make a change to control our output. If there's a delay on what's coming in versus what's coming out, a slower control signal coming out of here is going to have a delayed effect on what's happening on the output and perhaps not regulate it in the way we want. So those are the challenges. So let's just go to a little analogy. So let's paint the picture or analogy in terms of trying to understand what that op amp is doing and the potential challenges of trying to regulate the output and keep it stable. If you can picture over here, I've got a man with a big eye, and that'll be explained in a moment. He's got an arm holding onto, let's say, one of those slinky springs. You know, a slinky spring that you'd kind of march down a carpet. And at the end of that slinky spring, he's got a little weight. And it's a weight which is sitting inside a tube. So we've got this tube and the weight kind of fills the bulk of the diameter of the tube. And at the bottom of the tube, you've got a fan which can either blow air up against that weight or draw or suck air down. So it will potentially affect and play around with the level and stability of that weight in respect to the level it's sitting at inside that tube. Now let's say our ultimate goal is to have a regulated or maintain a stable level inside that tube of where that weight is. So this is like trying to maintain a stable level at the output of your power supply. We want a regulated level. Now we've got this man over here, he's holding that coiled spring where he can either lift up or adjust it down to try and maintain that level. So let's say that that fan happens to be drawing air down and sucking, he's going to have to pull up a bit to adjust and keep that at this set level or regulated level. And if the fan kind of changes direction and starts blowing air up, he might have to then push down. And of course, if that is happening fairly frequently, he's going to find himself in a situation where he's doing up, going up and down with a spring. And there's two things which are playing a part in terms of controlling that level. The up and down movement, and then the force which he's applying to try and change the level of that weight. So that up and down movement, or the speed of that up and down movement, will relate to the frequency. And then the force that he's applying will be kind of the gain or the magnitude, the measurement of the amount of gain that he's putting in to try and adjust to keep that weight at a certain level. Now, if you can imagine the scenario for yourself, if you are trying to do that, kind of control this weight at a certain level, and you've got that fan which is quickly changing, there'll be a certain point where, let's say it's changing but not very quickly, it kind of blows in one direction and then changes and goes in another, you could probably easily adapt to that. You could carefully adapt and get that going. As that change happens more quickly, the fan is kind of changing more rapidly in terms of between blowing and sucking, it's going to perhaps be far harder for you to adjust and keep that little weight stable as you're trying to move things faster. And this is one of the key problems in a control system. And let's say if we relate to our power supply, when the frequency, which is that speed that you're adjusting at, when the frequency starts going up and changing, that creates problems. And that's where understanding at what point the system can maintain control and a stable regulated system at a certain frequency versus, let's say, another frequency where it just goes out of kilter for some reason. Now, when say for some reason, why, what happens in terms of those reasons? Why do we lose control of trying to regulate the output? Well, if we go back to our man, and you can see I've got a triangle here which represents his brain. And that's a nice little triangle which represents the op amp in the power supply and our control system. He is looking down at that weight to see that it's sitting, and he's trying to maintain that regulated level with his eye. So he's looking down. That is the input or the feedback to his brain. So that is input through his eye into his brain. That's the feedback. And then the output is his arm goes out through his arm to adjust that spring up and down. Now, as you can imagine, as perhaps things speed up, his brain might not be working quick enough to make the adjustments. So the fan might be sucking, he might be pulling up to compensate, and then the fan might change direction and start blowing up. But if his brain is slow to adjust, and then only a moment later he starts putting down, and at that point the fan changes direction and starts sucking down, what happens? He's now almost amplifying things in the wrong direction because he's taken too long, there's a delay. Now, there's going to be a certain point where if there's a little bit of delay, as you can imagine, if you in real life looking at the situation, your brain doesn't react at exactly the same time. There will be a slight delay. And these systems can cater for a slight delay. What is the other way of compensating for this other than the time is the amount of force or movement that you're putting in to correct the situation. So even if there's a slight delay, if you're putting in enough force to correct the situation, you can still get back to a regulated level. However, you could be in a situation also where, let's say, you're reacting fast enough, but you're not putting in enough force. You then also, it's not going to come up quickly enough to that level, and if there's a change, even though you're adjusting quick enough, because you're not doing enough force or the magnitude of your adjustment, that you're also going to struggle to reach that level. But as long as you're actually doing that and in the correct time frame, you'll probably eventually get to a point where you do get it regulated. It's when both of those go against you. When you've got too much delay in your correction and you're also not applying enough force to regulate that level, that things go awry. So as I mentioned that's where I want to bring in a bit of math, and I'm going to come back to this analogy so that the kind of high-level mathematical side ties into that. Now, at this point in time, we need to introduce a little bit of math. We're going to go to high level. There is a well-known equation which explains the closed-loop feedback for a system like this. Now, if we go and have a look at this kind of diagram, we've got the op-amp, and then we've got the feedback. And in this little block over here where I've got this B or beta, that'd be the gain. Now the gain, let's say we have a value of 1 going in and then a value of 2 coming out. That'd be a gain of 2. So merely dividing the output over the input, you can understand what your gain is or measure the amount of gain. And going back to logarithmic systems, you're going to generally also see gain measured in dB. dB is a nice way of being able to represent a ratio, because you can also represent, besides you representing, let's say, a gain in terms of a ratio, you can show really small values against really big values and still have them represented on the same scale. That's the great thing about logarithmic scales. So in the system, to understand the equation, first of all, these equations are derived, as I said, from complex mathematics, which I don't want to go into. For one, I couldn't explain them, and that's what I found kind of throws you when people are going into the complex math and you have no understanding of it. But just accept that the feedback equation for a system like this, after a lot of mathematics, derives down to the V out equals V in multiplied by the open loop gain divided by 1 plus the feedback of the system. So that is the AB, is the feedback. Now, you'd have heard me mention open loop gain. So open loop gain is when you're not using feedback, you've got an open loop. To be able to design a system properly, it's very difficult to design around a closed loop system. So the specifications and the calculations for this are taken from open loop systems to derive this formula, which then applies to the feedback of a closed loop system, which is what we're ultimately looking for. The one important thing to note is in this equation, things will go awry. If you can remember your basic maths, you never want to divide by zero. Dividing by zero means infinity, and in this case, it means a system becoming unstable. So as we've got a 1 plus and our gain of AB here, if that AB factor over there was -1, then that would mean this equation would be divided by zero. And that's a situation you don't want to have. That's when you get infinite gain and things going awry and your circuit becomes unstable. So there's two situations which are going to lead, which when combined, lead to instability or oscillation in a feedback system. And that's when that goes to minus one. So that minus one. And that minus one means you're going to have a system result, end system result in terms of gain of one, which is 0 dB. A gain of one is no gain. So you put one in, you get one out. That's no gain, that is 0 dB. So that is what you want to avoid at 180 degrees phase difference. So now here we're gonna start getting to terms of like phase difference and phase margin. And that phase difference is the delay in the brain reacting to what it sees. And that's because we don't have ideal op-amps. We also have, and the whole reason this starts to happen is because you can design around a system where you've got everything where you think is working correctly, but you've got parasitics. And in electronics, those parasitics are capacitance, inductance, resistance. So if you've got two tracks on a PC board which are really close together, they can end up having some capacitance value, or two wires close together, or a bit of a coil in a wire, or your load on the output, when that changes in a certain way, all those, and perhaps a longer track or piece of wire increasing the resistance, you're going to have a potential resistance at the output to your op amp, which for the most part doesn't play a part, but as a frequency reaches a certain level, all these little bits start to interact. And when they start interacting, suddenly frequencies and odd things start happening, and we want to understand what that behavior is at those certain frequencies. So that phase difference we're talking about is when you've got that delay from an input. So let's say we have a signal coming in here, and we understand a sinusoidal signal moves through 360 degrees. So when you go up, you reach a situation where you've got 90 degrees, 180 degrees at the line, and you move around again until you complete and you get to 360 degrees. And in real terms, that means when we've got that delay, like I said, with a guy with a spring reacting slowly, if we have, let's say, our output over here noted in blue that is tending or wanted to increase for some reason, that is fed back through to our op amp. And remember, on our op amp, we are now talking about systems with negative feedback. So the negative feedback is processed by the op amp. What it needs to do, because this is tending to move up, because we're getting negative feedback, our output of our op amp is going to pull things down to correct in the opposite direction of what the output's wanting to do. And it's that delay that happens to that, which means you're not going to get a perfectly regulated output. But let's just go to a situation where, let's say, things are all perfect and all lined up correctly. So in this little graph over here, what I want to show you is we've got, let's say, our green line, which is representing our feedback into our op amp. And then the corresponding response or output from the op amp is in red. The blue is our output that we're trying to regulate. Now, as I noted, the one thing is that we're talking about, there's two things that come into play, and that is, for one, the phase or phase difference. The reason the output is sitting at an opposite angle like that is because we've got the inverted output, because we've got the negative feedback. So don't let that confuse you. In this situation, these two signals would be in phase. It's just that they inverted. The other thing to think about besides the phase, as I said, is the magnitude or amplification of the signal. Now, it depends on your control system, what is required to drive it. And in some cases, you may be amplifying a signal. In some cases, you may be attenuating the signal. But at the end of the day, there's going to be a right level or right amount of signal which adjusts your control system to regulate your output. So in the system over here, we're assuming that both of those are right, that your gain is at the right level and that you've got no delay. Things are actually happening right at the right time. So we've got our output, which happens to be tending up. That feedback is coming into the op amp. So that is rising at the input of the op amp. At exactly the same time on the output, you're getting a pull down to control that output to bring it back to the regulated level. just like the man with the spring. You've got the weight which is coming up and he's having to adjust his hand down to compensate and try and regulate the level of that weight in the tube. So here they're perfectly in tune. They're responding at exactly the right time with the right amount of force or gain to keep the output exactly regulated. So let's look at this situation over here where we've got a slight delay because the brain is reacting slowly or our op amp is reacting slowly or due to the kind of feedback and the capacitance or parasitics is causing an issue and delay in the system. If we have a look at this situation over here where we're getting that same feedback going into the op amp, but our output is delayed. Now, if you have a look at the peak over there versus the peak over here, you'll see they're not exactly in line as they were in this first example. The output, there's a delay in this case, I'm saying, of 90 degrees, and it's specified as minus 90 because it's a delay, it's a lag. So there's a lag in this output. It kind of then adjusts, but because of that, you'll see on the output, because there's that slight delay, you're going to get a slight wobble in your regulation of your output. And that you'll see in practical terms, let's say in the power supply, is you might have a slight bit of ripple on that output. But as long as things aren't going too far out, things will eventually settle in to the right level. And that's where, if you have a look at this line over here, you might recognize this where you've kind of got a little bit of disturbance on the output and then it slowly comes around and starts settling into the right level. And that's known as ringing. Now, I'm not saying that that's necessarily how it's going to behave in these situations. The actual behavior can be very complex, but it's one of those situations where as long as you haven't got things going too awry, your phase difference isn't too far out. You might have some instability for a little while in your output, and then it should settle into a regulated level. Then let's look at the situation here where we've got the worst case scenario where things go totally awry. Now here we've got a situation where we've got a delay of 180 degrees. So that's minus 180 degrees. So we've got that feedback coming to the op amp, but the output is 180 degrees behind it. So it's half a wavelength or half a cycle behind trying to adjust the output. And here we can see what happens. There's that slow delay. You can see the red line over here is behind, way behind the green line or the input. And what's going to happen with our output? It's going to start going off. It's not going to be regulated. We're going to see some change. But the problem here is in this situation, besides that delay that we've got, the amount of gain is at zero. So we're at 0 dB, it's at one. And if we've got no gain as well as 180 degrees delay, then we've got that situation where we're responding slowly and we're not responding with enough force to control that level. So we could still be 180 degrees out of phase. If we were applying enough correction, even though it was delayed, we could potentially get a situation where we pull it right. But here, we're not applying, we are slow in our response to try and correct, and we're not responding with enough force to get that weight at the right level if we're playing around with a spring. The so-called regulated level is going up. There's a slow response to correct that, but already the feedback into the op amp is seeing that it's in the wrong place. It starts adjusting again. There's a slow response at the output because we've got this delay. And inevitably, what happens? We've now got an unstable system which goes into oscillation. If we had those same situation, that's a graph over here, where you've still got a lag, let's say of 180 degrees, but our response at the output has got some gain, so it's not at 0 dB, you've got some gain to try and correct things, then you're going to, again, potentially have a situation where you have that kind of instability, a little bit of ringing at the output, it's a little bit unstable, and then hopefully it'll tend to correct itself. And it's at that point we want to understand right across a certain frequency range which we think our design will be exposed to. So design engineers will understand, right, I need to cater from 1 or 2 hertz or 50 hertz right up to 30 kilohertz, let's say. And they will then inject a signal into the system and measure the output. And by doing that and taking all those points across that, you'll generate a Bode plot. And the Bode plot can then give you an understanding of your margins or how safe things are to operate. So now here I bring in that word margins, and there are terms where I've been talking about phase difference. So that literally is a difference in the phase between the two, your input versus your output. A margin is a safety margin, a level that you can operate in before things go awry. So let me just show you an analogy about that. So if we go back to the analogy to understand margin, I've got a little diagram of a cliff over here. There's a guy standing at the top of a cliff and there's a fence. And that fence you can see is actually set back from the edge of the cliff. Now, of course, if he goes wandering off too far, he's going to fall off the cliff. And that's where you get your, let's say, instability or oscillation on your circuit. So they've got a fence sitting over here, not right at the edge, where potentially you're at risk of falling off the edge straight away if you cross that fence. There is a margin of safety. So even if he had to hop over that fence for some reason, he's not going to fall off the cliff straight away. There's an area he can still be without falling off the cliff. And when we talk about phase margin and gain margin, that's understanding the levels before you hit those critical points before things fall over. So why are we worried about having this margin? Well, when you're designing for a system like this, as noted, you can have these parasitics. You don't know what conditions necessarily your final design is going to operate under, or you need to cater for a range of conditions. One of those conditions might be temperature. So you may have all the resistance levels, the capacitance levels, and the inductance levels nailed down, but let's say it's hot. Suddenly, let's say resistance levels might go up, or the specification for your op amp might change slightly in the way it operates. That slight change might lead you over the edge to instability. So if you have a greater margin where you're further away from those, let's say that level of minus 180 degrees or 0 dB gain, that level of margin gives you an area to operate where it's safe and things aren't going to go awry. So just giving a quick chat about those margins. If we have a look, I mentioned before that when you're looking purely at a reference to where one signal is in respect to the other, we can talk about a phase difference. There's a phase difference between these two signals. Of course, taking into account that we've got inversion, which I'm catering for on the diagram over here. If we want to understand the phase margin, then we know the point at which things are unstable. That's at negative 180 degrees. So if we're taking this example that we've got a phase difference of minus 90 degrees. So it's minus 90 degrees. We need to understand what the margin is. So we say minus 180. So that is then minus 90, which turns into plus 180, which gives us 90 degrees. So we've got a 90 degree margin before we hit that 180. Now that's a good margin to have. And in fact, for most design criteria, they recommend that ideally you have a phase margin of greater than 60 degrees. So in this case, you would be there. You could go less than 60 degrees, but of course, the closer you're getting to that level, the more sensitive your circuit is going to be. And that's the other thing to remember, is that the less margin you have, the more sensitive your design is going to be to interference, which could send it into an unstable state or oscillate. And likewise, if we just look down at here before we get to the Bode plots, if we look at down over here, if you don't have enough margin in your gain and your gain is getting too close to that point where you add 0 dB, then again, that is where things are going to go awry. So although it's not perhaps necessary to understand all the complex maths behind this, although it can be quite helpful, certainly just understanding that feedback equation and understanding about the zero at the denominator is not a good thing mathematically. And this is all modeled on math. But the one really helpful thing you would really need to understand if you are going into design of these systems are Bode or Bode plots. So what is the Bode plot? Well, what we're doing with a Bode plot is, as I said, what you're doing is you can inject an input signal, and how they do this, I'm going to try and do this in a follow-up to this with a practical example. You put a low value resistor in the feedback loop, and you inject a signal into the input and you measure the response on the output. And you do that at stepped frequency levels. You step right through and you can get these plots. And from those plots, you can determine then the stability of your closed loop system. So you are going to be able to measure two things. Down here, the measurements you're looking for are again that shift in the phase and the change in the gain. So like for instance, as you go up in frequency, you might find that your gain is dropping off and reducing, which frequently happens. As you increase that frequency, because of the components and a cutoff level, the gain will reduce. And at the same time, you can have a slower response on the output, so you get more delay. And remember, it's a combination of the two, reaching the point where you've got 0 dB and you're reaching negative 180 degrees in your phase shift, that things go awry. So as you apply that test frequency, you're going to have a plot which shows you your magnitude or your gain in dB with respect to frequency. And likewise, you're going to have a graph which shows you your phase shift in phase according to your frequency. And what you do is you want to understand at critical points what your margin is. So this tool is to understand your margin of safety that we spoke about, so your phase margin and your gain margin, which gives you that little area of safety or sensitivity to play around in, and you'll know what that is. To get your phase margin, you look at the plot and where it reaches the 0 dB point, which remember is the dangerous point, that's the point you're trying to avoid, where your line, your magnitude line crosses at, you take a direct down look at your plot for phase. And in this case, I've got a line going down over here. You can see if I take a line down and take it across, it happens at that point, our phase response is at minus 90 degrees. Now we know at minus 90 degrees from the previous calculation, we've got a 90 degree phase margin. So that's the phase margin for the response here. Then what we do is we look at the phase plot, because now we want to understand the margin of gain. We have a look again at that dangerous point. That danger point is at minus 180 degrees. We've got a line, and when we bring that up, we then take that up to the magnitude plot and we take that across, and here it just happens to be at minus 10 dB. So the difference or the margin between our 0 dB line and down here is 10 dB. So we've got 10 dB margin of gain. So in this situation where this is graphed, we haven't got a situation where things are going to be out of control. But if we had a situation where both of those lined up, where we had our 0 dB, so if I take an example here and we're looking at the 0 dB mark and I draw a mark down here to minus 180, if my plot came down here at minus 180 degrees, then that would be an indication that we potentially have an unstable design or something which is going to go into oscillation. As you've seen from that, it's all about the control systems and the output, the delay in terms of doing the adjustment to regulate the output and the amount of control force, the gain. So that is that margin. Those margins are your safety areas, as I explained. Why do you need those safety areas? Because of sensitivity, the amount of change that can happen in your parasitic resistance, inductance, capacitance, can all affect how you strain to that area where you're going to be edging very close to a system which is unstable or starts oscillating. And I said, it doesn't just need to be componentry within the power supply, let's say. Let's say we've got all our resistances and capacitances adjusted. We could have something happening on the load. So where you perhaps go and do a Bode plot, let's say for instance you do it and you do it on a system which doesn't have a load, you're not catering for that change. So you might also have to cater for, let's say if you've got a capacitive load attached, that capacitive load is also going to interact with your feedback loop. And that feedback again starts changing with the frequency level. So even though you've done a Bode plot, if you haven't done it with all the components in place and catered for all the variables, things can go awry. But that's how things can go awry and how you can plot and understand where it's going to be stable in certain situations or unstable. How do you correct for that? And basically what you need to do is add resistance or change resistance values or capacitance values at certain points in the circuit. So let's say you might need to change the resistance at the output of the op amp, or you might have to add a little capacitor in the feedback loop. So all of that I'm hoping to bring to you in the next video. It's very tricky. Well, ideally what I want to do is set up a system on my bench where I've got an op amp operating in ideal conditions, and then I've got an op amp which is operating in a situation where it's going to be unstable or start oscillating. Well, I've already got that on my power supply, but I want to give you two models and hopefully be able to do a Bode plot. Now, doing a Bode plot can be potentially challenging because you need the right equipment to do it. Now, there are certain ways of injecting a signal and then measuring the output so you can do those plots, which do require specialized equipment. I do know that my Keysight oscilloscope in its power measurement caters for doing plots for feedback on situations on systems like that. However, I do know you need very special or very good one-to-one probes, which I don't have. So I'm going to play around. I'm going to try and get that system together so I can demonstrate that to you in the next video, all going well. And then from there is apply that and try and get my actual power supply to be stable. Now, hopefully you'll realize from this that where I was kind of at a loss for understanding why is my power supply oscillating at the moment when my college power supply, which is in essence the same components, is sitting there stable and working. Well, I've got long bits of wire. I haven't got it on a PCB. I've got it on a strip board. So there's a whole lot of variables over there which add those little parasitics, which then get it to a little state. It just hits those margins where you're close to the 0 dB and you're getting close to, let's say, minus negative 180 degrees of phase. And when you're getting close to those areas, those margins, you get your stability of the circuit is going to be affected. It's not going to be stable. And of course, if you hit the ideal points where things go awry, you're going to get oscillations and things totally go haywire. But anyway, that'll be left up the next couple of videos. If you've gained any value from this, please give it a thumbs up, and I'll catch you soon for the next one. Cheers.